Hello and welcome again to the lecture course on the early universe. So today I finish chapter 1, which is about the expanding universe. So next time really we go to the early universe, as the title suggests, to the radiation-dominated phase. But today we still have to discuss one important concept, which is applied in all phases of cosmology, and we need it in particular when discussing inflationary cosmology, the very early phase, because there we will have issues related to causality connections, and this is why we have to discuss horizons. Now, when we study causal structure, conformal time, eta, is of use, and here I wrote down the Robertson-Walker, the RW line element, here in with conformal time with the angle chi, and here this factor f squared depends on whether you have an open or closed or flat universe. So typically we will deal with radial light rays, so we adapt the coordinates such that this part is zero and we only have this part. Now, as already mentioned in the relativity class, and if you like, you can read in great detail in this section of the book by Hawking Ellis, these Robertson-Walker spacetimes, they are conformal to part of what is called the Einstein cylinder. So the Einstein cylinder, for example, if you have k equals plus 1, then I can draw this or sketch this picture of the cylinder, and so eta goes vertical, so you have, for example, here, and this is here the line eta equals 0, and this here is the eta equals 2 pi. So if you have no cosmological constant, then you have the standard solution of having a big bang here and having a big crunch here. Perhaps you recall this from the relativity 2 lecture, when we have this cycloid solution of this expanding and recollapsing universe, no? So maybe I can here sketch a of t over t, and then it looks like that is a cycloid. And this is part here, or can be mapped to part of this Einstein cylinder. This means that, in particular, Robertson-Walker spacetimes are conformally flat because the cylinder is flat. For you can also do this for k equals 0 and minus 1, but it's conformal to a more complicated region of the Einstein cylinder. And if you like, you can. See the discussion and the pictures in the book by Hawking Ellis. Now we can also draw a Penrose diagram. So for example, for k equals plus 1, so then we have here this rectangle, and so eta equals 2 pi would be here that. And the big bang here would be here, eta equals 0. So again, big crunch and big bang. And so horizontal lines are lines of constant conformal time eta. And the lines of constant chi, they are vertical. Let me draw them here. Some representatives here. So this is chi equals constant. Yeah, so this angle chi, and in particular we choose here chi equals 0 and chi equals pi. So chi ranges from 0 to pi. So I mean, if you have a cross section through the 3 sphere, then you would have here, say, chi equals 0 and chi equal pi, and this is that part of that 3 sphere. Of course, these two are coordinate singularities only, I mean, correspond to these arbitrarily chosen poles of the sphere, whereas these, of course, here, this and that model, are real singularities, the Big Bang and the Big Crunch. Now for k equals 0 and minus 1, so I should say this we called scry plus, and this is scry minus, and this is where light rays originate, and this is where light rays terminate. For and both are space-like. Now for the open and flat cases, the scry plus is no longer space-like, but it's light-like, or null-like. So if you have k is equal to 0 or minus 1, then scry plus is light-like. So and you have here a picture that it would look like that. So we have the Big Bang here, as before. So that's the Big Bang. And so these are lines of constant time here. And here we have the lines of constant chi. They look like that. So they all end here. So that's what we call I plus, that's the time-like infinity, and this is here scry minus, and scry plus is here. No? So you see here that this here is light-like, and this is why you can see here for here all the regions here. In contrast to this, and this is what gives rise to the concept of a horizon, because here we will have a horizon. You cannot see all of the space-time. And let me review this. I mean, it was defined in the relativity class, but I extend this here a bit. So we have particle horizons. Let me call it just PH. If you like, of course, there's a huge literature, and you can read the textbooks that are given on our website. But for this particular concept, I can also refer to a pedagogical article by Ellis and Husson, which you find on the archive under that number 1612-01084, if you like to read about that. So what are particle horizons? Particle horizons you can define as the word lines of limiting fundamental particles or co-moving observers, world lines that just follow the expansion, that can affect an observer at a particular point. So this is can be defined as the world lines of the limiting. So I draw a picture. I will draw a picture limiting fundamental particles or galaxies or whatever objects that can affect an observer O at a point P. Now, if such a limit exists, it may not exist, right? The limit. So to draw a picture, and it becomes clear from the picture, if I have this case here, let me just draw it again. So we have here eta 2 pi and eta 0, and we have here the lines chi equals 0 and chi equals pi, and we have other world lines, and now we have one particular world line. Maybe these are we. So here, for example, here, well, a co-moving world line, so no extra motion of an observer O, and let us consider a particular point P here. So we have here, say this is today. So and this is the value eta today. So which I call eta naught, or you can also use the old Friedmann time. So you can also use, of course, the t, but the eta is what is used here. And now I can draw the backwards light cone from here, which in that conformal diagram is just 45 degrees inclination. So that's the backward light cone. And so here you can have, as you see from here, information, of course, from the light cone and from the interior, but not from the outside. So you cannot have information that here from the outside enters here to P. So there are some limiting world lines, and they are the ones here. So this is what we call here the particle horizon. So, and we have world lines outside, like these green ones, about which you cannot see, at least not today. I mean, if when you proceed here in time, of course, you will see further world lines entering, but the concept of the particle horizon refers to particular time, no? And the horizon changes if you go from one time to the other. Now, so this particle horizon divides at the time eta naught or t naught all particles into two sets. Those which could have causal contact with P, so these are all the word lines here, and those which could not have causal contact. So all these green word lines here outside, they are outside the particle horizon. And here this is inside. So if I maybe just that this is not that the figure is not overloaded, so I will maybe have here, if you have here that P here, then I call this distance here, this coordinate distance, chi pH at t naught. So that's the coordinate distance, which is just an angle. It's the co-moving distance, not something in megaparsec. This we have still to calculate. So it's the corresponding angle here. So that's the co-moving distance. Distance to the particle horizon. So to calculate this limiting case, I mean, you have then here the S squared equals zero. This is our condition for the light propagation. And if we choose radial light, so we have the omega squared equals to zero. So it means then that we have here the eta squared, let me use back again the old time, because the Friedmann time still is the physical time here. So if we use Friedmann time, we have then dt squared is a squared of t d chi squared. Now you can have d eta squared is equal to d chi squared, or you can have dt squared is a squared of t d chi squared. Now from that you can calculate this here. So you have chi pH of t0 is defined as chi from 0 to t0. This would correspond, well, I first write this down, so this would correspond to 0 to t0 dt over a of t. And of course, you can have here a lower limit t1, a general limit t1. And if t1 goes to zero, like is the case here when you have a big bang, this would be the corresponding expression. If you have no big bang, then, for example, you can have also t1 is equal to minus infinity. Yeah, so that's what we have here for the coordinate value of the particle horizon, so dt over a of t. So the particle horizon also defines a two-dimensional surface. So the particle horizon defines a two-dimensional surface given by the present time and this chi pH at the present time, and of course you vary theta and phi, no? So this is why it gives it two dimensions here, right? So here you can have, and usually, or in some text, the particle horizon is defined as a time-like three-dimensional surface generated by all the world lines through this two surface. So that's maybe a matter of definition, whether you the particle horizon the two-dimensional one or the three-dimensional one all the way here. Now, the present physical size is of course the more interesting concept, because this is what you measure in centimeters or in megaparsec and not just in a coordinate. And this you get from this by multiplying with the scale factor, because the scale factor gives you the scale, right? And the scale factor gives you then the physical size, which has here the correct dimensions. The present physical size of the particle horizon is it. I should say it's a radius, not a diameter. I mean, it goes here in one direction, or I should say in one direction, but of course it could also in the other direction or in all directions. So it's a radius. So a radius. I call it dPH at the time t naught. This is then a of t naught times this coordinate distance, and this is a of t naught times integral from 0 to t naught dt over a of t. So that's the really the important quantity that you have to, if you have a Friedmann universe, of course, if you want to calculate the distance up to which, I mean the distance in megaparsec, up to which information can have reached you since the Big Bang. And this is of course an increasing function of the time t naught. Well, provided the integral exists, it could also be diverging and then there is no limit. But if it exists, then of course it increases with t naught. This means that more and more particles or world lines are visible from here with increasing time. Now you can see if I go here and I look back here, then of course I see more, because more time has elapsed and more information can have reached me since the beginning of the universe. So particles can never enter the particle horizon and leave it again. So once they're inside, they're inside, and they cannot leave it again. Sometimes, and I think in particular Alice Husson emphasized this point, so it's not made in all the textbooks. Another related concept is introduced called the visual horizon. The particle horizon is in a sense a theoretical concept, assuming that you really could look back to the Big Bang. But this is not what we can do. So we can at the moment only look back to the time when the cosmic microwave photons were released. And maybe in the future we can go look back further with gravitons or neutrinos. But so far that's not possible. And so from a more astronomical point of view, this is more the point of view of a theoretical physicist, we have this visual horizon. VH. So the universe, as we know it, is transparent after the time of so-called last scattering. You will learn more details in the next chapter about that. So the universe is transparent after the time of last scattering of the cosmic microwave background photons with charges. And you will see later this occurs at a rate redshift of around 1100. So this stands for last scattering surface. And so to give a picture here would mean that, well, I draw the picture here. Here, so if we have here t equals 0, and here we have the word line O, and we have here our point P, then there is a later time called the time TLSS, no, which is a couple of 100,000 years after the Big Bang, you will see. And so if we draw here that backward light cone, it would look like that. And so here, that's our earlier chi pH of T naught, but here that would correspond to the visual horizon. No? So here, this here would correspond then here to the chi visual horizon at T naught, no? Which is of course smaller because less time has elapsed and you see less or have less access to observations. So here, now that would be here, then the world lines here outside that you cannot see. As I said, we have observations of the cosmic microwave background. So that is, we have here the CMB observations. So this means that we have a visual horizon defined by the photons of the CMB. And that's the standard, that's what we can precisely determine. In principle, one can also observe or could observe neutrinos. At the moment, they are too weak. I mean, these primordial neutrinos, you will learn about them in the next chapter. So in principle, we could have a visual horizon for the neutrinos, or also for the gravitational waves or gravitons from earlier. But this is about the future, right? So far we cannot observe. So it's clear that this chi VH of T naught is smaller than chi BH of T naught. So this is always inside the particle horizon, as is obvious from the picture. Now the visual horizon then you can give by a similar formula as here, no, the coordinate horizon and the physical horizon. So we have here chi VH of T naught, so this is chi of the 2 times T naught and T last scattering. So this is the integral of from T last scattering to T naught dt over a of t. And and the physical one of course you get by multiplication with the scale factor. I don't write it down separately. Of interest is also the so-called primordial particle horizon. That's the horizon that you have at this point, right? So if you draw here, then the light comes back. So if we have here the primordial particle horizon, PPH, then PPH is a chi of T last scattering and 0. So it would be the integral from 0 to T last scattering surface dt over a of t. So this limits the causal interactions that are possible up to that time. So you will see later When we go to the very early universe, that there are problems in the standard model, that it seems that here there are many causal disconnected regions here at that time. And it's not understandable from this why these photons all have the same temperature. And this will motivate us to modify here the very early phase away from the radiation-dominated phase to what we call inflation, or inflationary phase. Now that's only an appetizer right now. You will appreciate this later and learn about it later. So that's what is important here. So this limits the causal interactions that are possible up to TLS. Of course, we have here that chi of pH T naught is chi of the visual horizon plus the primordial horizon here. So far for the particle horizons, of course you recall from the black holes that there another concept was more important, the concept of event horizon. Here in fact the concept of particle horizon is the more important one, because this limits really to what we can see today, and observations are made today for our universe. Nevertheless, we can also define event horizon here, and event horizon here, say for such a universe, is defined by limiting world lines, where at the very end of the universe, limit the regions that can be seen from those that cannot be seen. So event horizons So limits world lines that can be seen at all in the whole evolution of the universe. No? So if you have again this closed universe as a model, so here these two limiting values, okay, we have here the limitings of the chi, and so we have the world, our world line, so here, so then we, which we can draw back, here, so extend this a bit so that it's clear that there is a region here outside. So here, that's the world line O, and maybe that is our vantage point P, from where you can have here the backwards light cone here, which I just draw, which gives you the particle horizon. But if you continue, of course, up to the end of the universe, then you come to a limit, so to which you can see. Certainly these regions here, so galaxies that are here, you will never ever be able to see from our world line. So still this refers to a particular world line. I mean, of course, if you're here, then you can see different things. But here, I mean, we can only see everything that is here inside, and that's the event horizon. So so we can, for example, have if we relate it to today, so then we can call this distance here, that distance, chi eh, the coordinate distance today, right? I mean that's the light cone that, of course, you have to know the future of the universe, which you do not know, but I mean here on the blackboard we know. So here that is the limiting light cone, and this would correspond here to that value here of chi event horizon. So if an event horizon exists, yeah, which is not obvious, no, if you have an open model, as we have here, you see that here at a limiting point, we can see everything. Everything is within our backwards light cone. So here there are no secrets in that universe, but here in this closed one, where this is space-like, not like-like, there are limits and there are secret places that you will never hear of. So if this exists, then we define this by chi at the value t naught and t plus. So t plus is either plus infinity, an infinite time, or a finite future. Now here it's a finite future of the Big Crunch, but you could also imagine of something that goes on forever, and you have here infinity. And so if it integral from t naught to t plus of dt over a of t converges. So it's a finite value. If this is so the end of our of the future, which can be infinity or finite, and if this converges, then an event horizon exists, and we can give the coordinate distance here. So a photon emitted from key event horizon at t naught towards the origin reaches this here at the final point. No? So if you have a photon sent from here to here, you reach our world line here finally. That's what means event horizon today. That's the if you look around here in the universe in the sky, that's the furthest event that could in principle observed by us in the far future. As I said, they are event horizons are of minor importance because they refer to limits in the far future, and at the moment really we have no clear picture of the far future of the universe, and so it's more a theoretical concept. This is different from the black hole case, more a theoretical concept, and what astronomers usually want is to have the particle horizon. So because we don't have enough now of concepts, we introduce a final one that you find in cosmology, is the so-called Hubble horizon. And unfortunately, sometimes there's confusion in the literature about this. So let me be precise about this concept. So let us call Hubble horizon, although this is not really a horizon in the strict sense. So HH, Hubble horizon. We have if we are in a Friedmann universe, we have the expansion or contraction, and this is described by the Hubble parameter H. No? And so if we have H to the minus 1, this gives us a typical time scale of the expansion, if you set speed of light equal to 1, a corresponding scale, no? If you have some c times h to the minus 1. No? So this defines a time scale of expansion, respectively scale RH, no, so which is for c equals to 1, speed of light equals to 1, which is the Hubble radius. The Hubble radius. Now, this is not directly related to causal limits, apparently, it's just a scale. But nevertheless, it will be important for the dynamics of the perturbations that we treat with in the second part of our lecture course, the inhomogeneous universe, because there we do not just have the background, which is Friedmann, we also have modes, and these modes have wavelengths lambda. No? They can be very early quantum fluctuations, later classical fluctuations, but these wavelengths, they correspond to perturbations, and they are important for the study of structure formation. And the important question is whether or not a particular wavelength is affected by the cosmic evolution. And for this, we have to study differential equations for the modes and find out, I mean, the corresponding causal limits, if you like. And in these differential equations, the Hubble parameter enters, and the Hubble scale enters. And this is why it is also important. No? So this here is not directly related to causal limits. But important for perturbations. No, so this is what we discuss later, but I already, because it fits here in that context, I explain it here. For perturbations, namely one, so for a mode, so if we have a mode with wavelength lambda, so affected or not affected by cosmic evolution depends on I mean the relation between these two scales. So you will see later when we discuss differential equations. But you should carefully distinguish it really from this concept of particle in the event horizon. Maybe all of this, which is abstract, becomes clear if you make an example. So let us do the following example. So we have a cosmic fluid with equation of state, as we all often had now, that pressure is equal to a constant times the density. And in addition, let me choose k equals 0 and lambda equals 0 to be simple. So we will later, at the end of today, treat the Sitter space, which has a positive lambda. So we have from the Friedmann-Lemaître equation, see last lecture, this universe expands as a power law t to the n, and n is a 2 to the 3 times 1 plus w. Now let me discuss event horizon, particle horizon, Hubble horizon for this particular model. So first let us have the event horizon. So we have dt over t on n. So in that case, the universe expands forever. So the limit here then is infinity. It's not a big crunch. And so you have an event horizon if this converges. And this means that n is bigger than 1. And this would mean w is smaller than minus 1/3. And this would mean that rho plus 3p is negative, no? From this here. And if you recall, rho plus 3p bigger or equal to 0 is a so-called strong energy condition. And so this would correspond to a violation of the strong energy condition. So for ordinary matter, we have no event horizon. Actually, implicitly, I have assumed that we have here ordinary matter that does not violate the strong energy condition. Otherwise, this would not be correct, this picture, yeah. Because here you have no event horizon. But if you have a violation of this, which is not true for radiation and dust, then in principle you can have event horizon. Now, there are also event horizons for lambda positive and k equals 1. Now for the particle horizon, you have this integral. Then you have a big bang, and okay, it depends on here the lower limit now, because that's what you have here. You look back to the beginning. So if this converges, you have a particle horizon, and okay, this you have here n smaller than 1, and this leads to w bigger than minus 1/3, so rho plus 3p positive. No? So here you have then the strong energy condition is fulfilled, and if it's fulfilled, you have a particle horizon. There are also particle horizons for a closed universe and lambda positive. Now, for the just let me here maybe this one line, the physical distance dph of g naught. Yeah, so you have to multiply this by this here. So you have here then t to the 2 over 3 times 1 plus w times the integral from 0 to t naught dt over t to the 2 over 3 1 plus w. Now that's the scale, the initial value of the scale factor here cancels out whatever, so it only depends here on the ratio between the two. And it's easily calculated, so it's 3 times 1 plus w over 1 plus w times t naught. So that's then the physical radius that you can easily calculate in this simple model. For example, if you have w equals 0, this is dust. This is the Einstein de Sitter universe. Recall what we had last time, Einstein de Sitter, beginning of the 1930s. There you have here dPh. It's 3 times t naught. No? If you have here w equals 0, it's just a 3, 3 times t naught, which is 2 times Hubble constant to the minus 1, because here this is 2/3, as we had calculated last time, of h naught to the minus 1, so this is twice h naught to the minus 1, which would be, for the presently measured value, about 9 gigaparsec, which would be too small, I mean, to be in accordance with observations. I mean, if you have our present universe with a positive lambda, you can do the similar calculations, just that it's more complicated because, as you recall, we don't have just a power law, but there you get then about 14 gigaparsec. That would be the relevant number, 14 gigaparsec, for the present size of the particle horizon. That is, for the present universe, okay, you can see only to the past, but the present universe, if you have the distance up to which there exist objects from which you could have information since the Big Bang. Yeah? And this is from here in all the directions 14 gigaparsec. Yeah? This is when you calculate that number, not for that simple model, but for lambda positive, which I had done in my relativity 2 class. So just to conclude this here, let us calculate the Hubble horizon for this particular model. Now recall we had A proportional t to the n. So we have the Hubble scale or Hubble horizon is h to the minus 1 of t. And so if you insert that, it's simply then t over n. We just have to calculate a dot over a and the inverse. So we have here h today. We can express, I mean, if we insert here n 3 times 1 plus w over 2 times t naught. And so from this, we can relate this to the particle horizon. Just calculate it over rh t naught, and find this is 2 over 3 over 1 plus 3 W, for example, it is equal to 1 if we have radiation. So this means that although there are really drastically different concepts in many models, the numerical values are not so different from each other. This is why there's generally a confusion about this, because in many models, just from the numbers, they roughly coincide. For example, for radiation dominance, this is just 1, and there the Hubble horizon is the particle horizon. But not for others, and this the most important other case where they really differ is the Sitter space. And this is what I discuss here now at the end of the today's lecture. So this is the Sitter space, and it will be especially important when we later discuss inflation, the inflationary universe. So this is was first discussed by famous Dutch astronomer Willem de Sitter, who lived from 1872 to 1934, and the solution is from 1917. So from the very same year when Einstein published his first paper on cosmology, where he applied his relatively new theory of general relativity to the universe as a whole, and immediately the same year de Sitter came with this. I mean, in this first paper by Einstein, he had introduced the cosmological constant in order to have a universe that is static, because he wanted to counteract the attractive feature of gravity of the universe by a repulsing force, which is provided by the cosmological constant. We discussed this in the last semester. And de Sitter pointed out that from the very same equations, if you have vacuum, you can have an expanding universe. So you can have not just a static universe, as Einstein suggested. So you can write the Einstein equations in the form r mu nu is lambda g mu nu plus 8 pi g t mu nu minus 1/2 g mu nu t, and this is the trace of t mu nu. So if you have vacuum, we have r mu nu is lambda times g mu nu, from which you can calculate a Ricci scalar. It's 4 lambda, just making the trace, and this you can write as 12 h lambda squared. You will see, I mean, this will be the Hubble parameter of the Sitter space. Now, we can have, of course, lambda 0, this would be Minkowski space. We can also have lambda negative, the so-called anti-de Sitter or ADS space, which is very popular in some circles of theoretical physics. But here, we restrict ourselves to the Sitter space, because that's what seems to be most important, both for the future of our universe and also for the past, which is about inflation, what we discuss later. Now, our universe, as I told you, currently is expanding, but in an accelerated way, and it seems that we have a positive lambda, and this means that asymptotically it seems that the universe will enter the Sitter phase. So it is important for us. Now, because the Sitter space is a highly symmetric solution, as is Minkowski space, there are many simple coordinate systems, not just one simple coordinate system, because this high symmetry allows to have many nice coordinate systems. So many simple coordinate systems. And the first one is so-called static form. Ds squared is minus 1 minus lambda r squared over 3 dr squared plus 1 minus lambda r squared over 3 to the minus 1 dr squared plus r squared d omega squared. So that's the static form. So r equals 0, you see this is a Schwarzschild type form, but the difference is that r squared is here in the numerator and not in the denominator. So r equals 0 is completely irregular, as it must, because the Sitter space is a homogeneous space. So every point looks like any other point, so it cannot be singular. Otherwise it would be singular everywhere. Well, so that's a static form. It has a coordinate singularity only at r. Well, if this is set to 0, this is r is the square root of 3 over lambda. Actually, this is what will turn out to be the event horizon. I will calculate this, but I can write it down already. So that's very similar to the black hole case here. But r equals 0 is completely regular. Now the Sitter space you can maybe better explain in a Penrose diagram. So that's here, this that square here, and let me maybe have here colors. So the light cones here going along the diagonals, and so here that would be r is the square root of 3 over lambda. Of course, this would have to be calculated, the Penrose diagram, and would take too long to calculate this here. But you can find this, for example, in books such as Hawking and Ellis, if you really want to to the calculations of the Penrose diagram. I mean, we have discussed this to some extent in the last semester. Now here you have world lines that have this form here. So they are, I mean, if this, if we use this coordinate system, this is r equal constant. So it's a time-like here outside, as in the Schwarzschild metric, but it's here space-like here. So that's also r equals constant. And you can have regions. So there's a region here, which is maybe our vantage point, call it region 1, and region 2, region 3, and region 4. So it looks a bit like in the black hole case, but there's no singularity here inside. Now t equals constant are then these straight lines here. So here, this is t equals constant. Oops, this is t equals constant, and here you would have t to infinity and t to minus infinity here. Now, and of course the asymptotic regions here are scry minus and scry plus. So we have here scry minus r is infinity and scry plus r is plus infinity. Now I think I have now explained everything. You can have here r equals 0, and here again r equals 0, but that's not the same r. Again, we have the 3 sphere, and r equals 0 is a pole, and r equals 0 is the other pole. So r goes from 0 to 1 and then back to 0. So you see from this that 1 and 3 are static. So this means d over dt is time-like. Now that are these regions here, 1 and 3, whereas the interior is dynamic. No? So 3, 2 and 4 is dynamic. So d over dt, that scaling vector, is space-like. Now r, okay, I should say here that this here is we call h lambda to the minus 1, as I did already earlier. Now the Sitter space, I will not write this down again. We did this in Relativity 2, can be mapped and can be mapped isometrically to a four-dimensional subspace of a auxiliary five-dimensional Minkowski space. And this is just a hyperboloid. It can be depicted as a hyperboloid, which looks like that. So it has here this kind of structure. No, it does not look very nice, but I think you know what I mean. It's here, it looks like that. So, and we have here then t equals constant. Okay, this is actually a different t than here, because this here covers only part of the full manifold, and the full manifold is actually covered by coordinates ds squared is minus dt. Maybe I call it dt bar squared so that you are not confused. Let me call it. So usually in textbooks, I mean, everything is called t, but in principle, that's a t referring to this coordinate system, a t referring to the other coordinate system. So let me call it like that, 3 over lambda cos squared of square root of lambda over 3 t bar, and then I have d chi squared plus sine squared chi d omega squared. And so it has really the structure of r, which rests to time, times S3. So all of this here are three spheres. Of course, I can here draw only a one sphere, but they are three spheres that you can imagine as contracting, having a minimal distance or minimal radius of square root of 3 over lambda, and then re-expanding. And the lines r equals constant, they are here, these lines here. Yeah. So here, this would be the r equals constant lines. No, and from this here, you really see that it's dynamic all in all. No? So you can have cover, you can cover part of it by static coordinates, but if you want to have the whole manifold, it's really dynamic. And so this covers the full manifold. And so in a sense, from the mathematical point of view, that's the most suitable coordinate system that you have. And you have here, you see the scale factor, a squared is 3 over lambda cos squared times square root of lambda over 3 times t. If you like, I mean, this has been discussed at length in the literature, even in very early literature. Still, a very nice reference is a small book by Schrödinger called Expanding Universes, which is published with Cambridge University Press in 1956, where Schrödinger discussed very nice geometric properties of these hyperboloids. But what is of interest here for us is, of course, the horizons. And this is what I would like to calculate at the end. Now, so perhaps I should here also draw, again, have the Penrose diagram here, which is the scribe plus. It's the same structure, but here we have then the lines r equals zero, r equals constant, and we have here, so t bar equals constant. And so just to emphasize that here, that very same manifold here is covered by these coordinates in this way, without coordinate singularity. I mean, here you have a coordinate singularity, and you could imagine perhaps you have first found this, and then in the same way as you went from Schwarzschild coordinates to Kruskal coordinates, recover the black hole, to get rid of this, then you find this coordinate system like the Kruskal one that covers everything. Also here we have chi equals 0, and here we have chi equals pi. So we have here, this is t bar is minus infinity, and this is t bar is plus infinity. There's also, I should perhaps write down this also, we have the here the spatial slices are three sphere, but you can the same hyperboloid part of it, half of it, if you can foliate it such that the spatial slices are flat. That's due to this high symmetry. It has confused many people, especially in the earlier years, and there's a lot of confusing literature about the Sitter space. Some say it's static, others say it cannot be static. It's just highly symmetric, and you can have very different coordinate systems. So here we also have, the s squared is minus dt squared plus e to the 2 square root of lambda over 3t. And then you have flat slicing, the x squared plus dy squared plus dz squared. So that's the Robertson-Walker form with k equals 0. So if you, for example, have the Friedmann equation here for that, we have here the Friedmann-Lemaître equation, a dot squared is lambda a squared over 3 minus k. And if we have then here, because k is 0, lambda a squared over 3, then of course we have here a of t is proportional to e to the square root of lambda 3 times t, which, because a dot over a, you see, is constant, so we have here that's e to the h lambda t. So that is what I defined to be the constant, actually, Hubble parameter of the Sitter space. It's actually the one for this flat slicing. And here, if you calculate from here, of course, you would have some different value. But this here, if you write down, if you define an h lambda, it would correspond to the expansion in the flat slices. So I don't draw this into the Penrose diagram. So let me go at the end to the horizons in the Sitter space. So horizons in the Sitter space. So let me first address the event horizon. So this is integral from t naught to infinity, dt over a and t. Okay, this exists. This integral exists, so the converges is finite. So this means that for all these coordinate systems, we have an event horizon that can be expressed in all of these coordinate systems. For example, if you have k equals 0, then we have a of t is some initial value times e to the square root of lambda over 3 times t, which we can call a1 times e to the h lambda t. And we can easily calculate then the event horizon of t naught, which is then a of t naught integral from t naught to infinity dt over dt. Now recall, that's the physical distance as measured in the today's universe, from which up to the very end of that universe information can be received by us. And that universe expands forever, right? It's not a big crunch universe, but still it, because of the exponential law, this is converging, and you can easily insert this here and convince yourself that this is just 8 lambda to the minus 1. So you see, in this particular case, the Hubble horizon or Hubble scale coincides with the event horizon. So h lambda to the minus 1 is for the Sitter space equal to the event horizon. And because this is constant, this holds for any time. I mean, it's called here T naught, but this is a constant. So because of the symmetry, that's the same all the time. So event horizon is equal to Hubble scale. So every event that at the time T naught and any other time happens at a distance bigger than that will be forever invisible. And that's the event horizon. But the more important thing is what we can see by looking in the past. And this is our particle horizon. So if we have k equals plus 1, then we have a is a naught cosh h lambda t. And if you insert it into the integral, which is from minus infinity, because it has no Big Bang, it's from times, I mean arbitrary early times, up to today. So dt over e of t converges. But let me consider, because the calculation is simpler, the flat case here, the flat slicing. I mean, you can calculate it in the slicing where you have the three spheres, but you can calculate in the slicing where you're flat. So that's confusing because of the symmetry. I mean, later you will learn when we discuss the early universe that we also have matter, and that it spoils the symmetry to some extent. So use k equals 0 with a of t is a 1 times e to the h times t. So then dph of t is then e to the h lambda t times integral from t1 to t, which is e to the minus ht dt, and this gives h lambda to the minus 1 e to the h lambda t minus t1 minus 1. Of course, then you should send this to minus infinity for the Sitter space, if the Sitter space, I mean, is there's no other phase of the universe. So this here for t much bigger than, or you say t is much, much bigger than t1. Let's make that argument. Then you have here h lambda to the minus 1 e to the h lambda times t, which in fact is much bigger than h lambda to the minus 1. No? And this is proportional to a itself. So that's actually typical for situations where the strong energy condition is violated, that we have this here. So this is typical for situations with rho plus Vp negative. We have a faster increase than h to the minus 1. Due to this, and this will help us very much, as you will see later when discussing the inflationary universe. So I think I was a bit quick in what I said here, and I think I said something wrong. This is of course for really valid for a finite value of t1. And if I have t1 really to minus infinity, then this here actually diverges. No? I think I was a bit quick, you know, here. What we really mean here is for time is much bigger than the initial time, we have here this drastic increase. But if you have eternal the sitter, then that started at minus infinity, then there you can practically see everything because of that infinite duration. So all points actually were in causal contact with each other. And there is no problem with causality, as we see later. So the last thing is the Hubble horizon or Hubble scale. So if we consider k equals 0 slices, then of course we have h lambda is square root of lambda 3 is a constant. And okay, so the Hubble scale is just that constant radius which coincides with the event horizon scale, as you see here from above. But you can also have a co-moving Hubble scale. Co-moving is always with respect to the expansion of the universe. So the co-moving Hubble scale would be then proportional to, or would be h lambda to the minus 1, and you have proportional to e to the minus h lambda over t. And so, which means at late times the co-moving world lines, they leave our Hubble sphere. I mean, this really, as you see, shrinks. The co-moving Hubble scale shrinks. So everything goes then outside this at some point. Okay, that's all. I mean, you will appreciate this later when we discuss the inflationary universe. But as a point to keep attention there, in addition, matter will be relevant. So, and this will spoil this full symmetry. Otherwise, I think we could not make inflation to work. But I mean, the message from here is that we have these various concepts of horizon. Important is the particle horizon, and the Hubble horizon will be relevant later when we have perturbations. And for the Sitter space, which is important also for the future of our universe, you see here there is this fundamental limit, which is the radius of the event horizon. So assume that our today's universe, we have measured this value, and if we really assume that lambda is constant, there's this issue about dark energy, but if lambda is constant, then it will go to the Sitter asymptotically, right? And asymptotically, it will have that Hubble scale h lambda to the minus 1 with our measured lambda, that we have that value lambda, which means that if this is really the correct model of our universe, then it would mean that today we cannot have, or we will never ever, even if we become infinitely old, never ever observe events that are farther away today than this value, which is about 14 gigaparsec. So that's really a fundamental limit. So independent of how big all of this is, that's a fundamental limit. Okay, this concludes the chapter 1, and now we are ready, we have all the concepts ready for proceeding earlier to the past, to the radiation-dominated phase. So I hope you will all be listening also next time when we enter the hot universe. Bye-bye.